Good morning. It is June 7th, and I'm glad you're here. Welcome to worship with First United Methodist Church in downtown Champaign. My name is Julia Malgreen, and it is my privilege to serve this congregation as its pastor. I'd like to let you know that if you are a young adult between the ages of 23 and 38, we have a young adult group that meets online on Monday nights. And if you'd like to be a part of that, please fill out a Connect card on our website and let us know. We'll get the information to you. Also, today is Peace with Justice Sunday. Timely, isn't it? If you'd like to make a contribution to Peace with Justice endeavors through the denomination, you're welcome to send a check, clearly mark it Peace with Justice Sunday. Let us turn our sights, our thoughts, and our hearts to God and worship.
A love that never ceases.
A creativity that designed the universe.
A hope that cannot be quenched.
A pursuit of justice and reconciliation, no matter the cost.
These are the things that are of God.
So let us worship God.
Oh, Embracing God, you grace each of us with equal measure in your love. Let us learn to love our neighbors more deeply so that we can create peaceful and just communities. Inspire us to use our creative energies to build the structures we need to overcome the obstacles of intolerance and indifference. May Jesus provide us the example needed and send the Spirit to warm our hearts for the journey. Amen.
Shall the King say unto them, upon his right hand, come ye blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world, from the foundation of the world. Come ye blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. Come ye blessed of my Father. Hungry and you gave me meat. I was athirst and you gave me drink. I was a stranger and you took me in. Naked and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came unto me. You came unto me. Therefore, come.
Now it's come to the time in the service to recognize our amazing graduates. We'll be starting with our high school grads. Lauren Bradamus is graduating from Champaign Centennial High School. Next fall, she will attend the 14-week highway construction program at Parkland in the fall of 2020 and then work for around 9 months. Starting in the fall of 2021, she will start as a full-time student majoring in business at Parkland for a year, then transferring to Illinois State University. Leah Fields is graduating from Champaign Central High School. Next fall, she will attend the University of Illinois in the College of Agricultural, Consumer, and Environmental Sciences. Olivia Geis is graduating from Champaign Centennial High School. Next fall, Olivia will be attending Parkland College. Quentin Murphy is graduating from Apex Virtual Learning Academy. Next fall, he will be playing junior hockey for the NAHL Kansas City Scouts with hopes of being recruited to play NCAA Division I hockey with a major in political science. Liliana Rice is graduating from Champaign Central High School. Next fall, she will attend the University of Illinois to study graphic design. Joseph Simmons is graduating from Champaign Centennial High School. Next fall, he will attend Parkland Pathways to study advertising. Rachel Shamba is graduating from Champaign Central High School. She will continue her studies in either nursing or social work. Sophia Uppinghouse is graduating from Champaign Central High School. Next fall, she will be studying nursing at Parkland College. And now for our college grads. Anna Benson graduated from the Illinois Institute of Technology in December 2019 with a bachelor's degree in computer science. She is currently working at Relativity in Chicago as a software engineer. Riley Berner graduated from Parkland College with an associate's degree in science. Next year, he will continue on to the University of Illinois to study natural resources and environmental science. Ryan Berner graduated from Parkland College with an associate's degree in graphic design. Following graduation, he will be pursuing a career in graphic design. Sarah Curtis graduated from the University of Illinois with a master's degree in human resources and industrial relations. Following graduation, she will be working as a human resources associate at Delta Airlines in Atlanta, Georgia. Madison Rice graduated from the University of Illinois in the College of Media. Following graduation, she plans to use her degree and unique experiences to pursue a career in television production. Hillary Rose Veach graduated from the University of Illinois with a Master of Arts in Teaching English as a Second Language. Following graduation, she will be working at Rantoul High School as an ESL teacher. Congratulations to all of our amazing graduates. We are so proud of you, and we are praying for you on each step in your future.
We are going to read the Book of Acts this summer together, so grab a Bible and find the Book of Acts. It's in the New Testament, so it'll be toward the back. During the month of June, I'd like you to read the first 10 chapters. Acts is the story of the Christian church. It is the story of the people who led the church, lived the faith, and who set an example for us 2,000 years later. Last week we read about Pentecost when the power of God's Holy Spirit came on those first disciples, those early believers, and empowered them. We heard Peter give his first evangelistic sermon, answering the question, what should we do? He told them to have changed hearts and lives, to repent of their sins, be forgiven, receive the Holy Spirit, and start a new life. We'll read more about Peter as we go through the book of Acts. We'll be introduced to St. Paul. We'll study about the difficulties the early church faced and how they made decisions together. And we'll be inspired by the risks they took to take the good news of Jesus Christ into the world. We'll read about diets, imprisonment, shipwrecks, snake bites, angels, and visitors and visions. I encourage you to read Acts this summer. 28 chapters. You can do it. I hope that we will draw courage from these first Christians. Our scripture reading for today comes from the book of Acts chapter 2. There's a few verses there, and there's a few verses in chapter 4 that we're going to take a look at. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. Awe came upon everyone because many wonders and signs were being done by the apostles. All who believed were together and had all things in common. They would sell their possessions and goods and distribute the proceeds to all as any had need. Day by day, as they spent much time together in the temple, they broke bread at home and ate their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having the goodwill of all the people. And day by day, the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. And then from Acts chapter 4. Now the whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one claimed private ownership of any possessions, but everything they owned was held in common. With great power, the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as owned land or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold. They laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need. There was a Levite, a native of Cyprus, Joseph, to whom the apostles gave the name Barnabas, which means son of encouragement. He sold a field that belonged to him, then brought the money and laid it at the apostles' feet. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Will you join with me in prayer? We come to you, Lord, with our spirits wide open, our minds ready to receive a word from you, direction from you, wisdom from you. Our spirits are tender this week. We are looking for your will and for your way. And we pray that by the power of the Holy Spirit, we might know where you would have us go and what you would have us do. In Christ's holy name, amen. Since we last gathered for worship together, a week has passed. What difference does a week make, really? You know, most weeks fly by with a lot of the same stuff. 21 meals have been prepared and eaten, laundry's been done, parents have gone to work, kids have passed the time, dishes have been washed, arguments have been had, bills have been paid. Normal week things, week after week, right? But some weeks make a big difference. Some weeks have events that change everything. Young people have graduated from high school and college in these weeks. Congratulations to our graduates on their accomplishment. We are proud of you and look forward to the next directions your life takes. For these graduates, life has turned a corner and they have a new view in front of them. Heading into adulthood is full of excitement as you figure out who you are and what you want to accomplish next. I encourage you to stay close to your church family if you stay here in town, and if you move someplace else, find a community of faith. A community of faith is a gift for a lifetime, giving joy and wisdom and guidance and support. I hope that you will always find your way into a faith community. Some weeks have big events that change everything. For the followers of Jesus, the week of Pentecost changed everything. After Jesus' death, they were fearful followers, and after receiving the power of the Holy Spirit on Pentecost, they were powerful proclaimers of the good news that Jesus Christ came to teach. They were changed, and they were fearless. I'd like for us to look today at what they did with this new power they had. I want us to take a look at what the scripture says they did to spend their time. In the first verse that we read today, it says this: they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and prayers. That's it right there. That's at the heart of who we are and what we do. We are the people who learn, we build community, we break bread together, and we pray. Those are the powerful means by which we become world changers. But there's more. Awe came upon everyone because many wonders and signs were being done by the apostles. All who believed were together, had all things in common. They would sell their possessions and goods and distribute the proceeds to all as any had need. Day by day, as they spent much time together in the temple, they broke bread at home and ate their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having the goodwill of all the people. And day by day, the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. Those early disciples, they were modeling a new way of being human together. They caught a glimpse of the kingdom of God, and they were trying to live into it. They shared what they had with any who had need. They praised God, and people witnessed them in action and were moved to become followers of Jesus Christ. How they were living gave a witness. They looked like they were onto something. And then the final part. Now the group of those who believed were of one heart and soul. And no one claimed private ownership of any possessions, but everything they owned was held in common. With great power, the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them. There was not a needy person among them. They were of one heart and one soul. There was not a needy person among them. That's the picture the book of Acts paints of the earliest disciples. It is a picture that we want to live into as well. How did they come to this generosity of life and intentional care for the poor? Well, we're going to go back to that first sentence again. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. All right, what's that mean? In Judaism, and their faith tradition was Judaism, they didn't really separate yet. That was all emerging now. So in Judaism, and their faith tradition was Judaism, gathering in a faith community meant reading the sacred text together and discussing it. Rabbis would teach and debate. People would listen, discuss, and learn, gleaning wisdom from their tradition, their history, grasping what God desired for their future. For sure, they would have reminded themselves as they sat and listened to the apostle teaching. They would have reminded themselves of the story of God liberating them from slavery when Moses led them out of slavery through the desert and to the promised land. That became the hallmark story for the Jewish people. So they would have talked about that, what it was to be slaves and how God had led them out. That story of being led to freedom might have reminded them of this passage from Leviticus. The foreigner residing among you must be treated as your native born. Love them as yourself, for you were foreigners in Egypt. I am the Lord your God. They would have recalled the many passages in scripture like this one from Exodus 22 that says we need to care for widows and orphans, the most economically vulnerable among us. It reads, you shall not wrong a sojourner or oppress him. This is about travelers and immigrants. For you were sojourners in the land of Egypt. You shall not mistreat any widow or fatherless child. If you mistreat them and they cry out to me, I will surely hear their cry. I'm guessing they read from the prophets. The only scripture they had was what we call the Old Testament. Perhaps they read this passage from Isaiah 58. And as I read this, I'd like you to close your eyes. I'm going to read it slowly. I want you to hear it and take it in. Isaiah 58. Is not this the kind of fasting I have chosen, to loose the chains of injustice and untie the cords of the yoke, to set the oppressed free and break every yoke. Is it not to share your food with the hungry and to provide the poor wanderer with shelter? When you see the naked, to clothe them, and not to turn away from your own flesh and blood. Then your light will break forth like the dawn, and your healing will quickly appear. Then your righteousness will go before you, and the glory of the Lord will be your rear guard. Then you will call, and the Lord will answer. You will cry for help, and God will say, "Here am I." If you do away with the yoke of oppression, with the pointing finger and malicious talk, and if you spend yourselves in behalf of the hungry and satisfy the needs of the oppressed, then your light will rise in the darkness, and your night will become like the noonday. The Lord will guide you always. He will satisfy your needs in a sun-scorched land and will strengthen your frame. You will be like a well-watered garden, like a spring whose waters never fail. They would have been shaped by the words of the prophet Isaiah in understanding how they were to live in community and what their task from God was. They would have certainly repeated what Jesus said as he began his ministry, his words recorded in Luke chapter 4, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovering of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." Or they might have retold the parable of the sheep and the goats. "When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, he will sit on his glorious throne. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate the people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will put the sheep on his right and the goats on his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, 'Come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger and you invited me in. I needed clothes and you clothed me. I was sick and you looked after me. I was in prison and you came to visit me.' The righteous will answer him, 'Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you?' The king will reply, 'Truly I tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did for me.'" In listening to the teaching of the apostles, they heard the whole story of God's love for them, and God's love, compassion, and mercy for all people. God's expectation that the people who claim to love God will act on behalf of the people who are most vulnerable, the foreigners in their midst, the orphans, the widows, the poor, and the oppressed, not just with charity, but with justice. Following Jesus can't be our side gig, just one more thing we try to juggle in our busy lives. Following Jesus is the main event, our first loyalty and our first allegiance, the driving passion for every choice we make, the consuming focus of our life's energy. Generous charity, caring for the poor and oppressed until there is not one who is needy among us, breaking the bonds of injustice, is the work of kingdom building for the people of God. So what difference does a week make? In America, this week has made a difference. Protests and riots, heavy hearts and cries of lament. We have seen our communities mourn the horrific death of George Floyd, who was laid to rest. May he rest in power. We have felt the surge of renewed commitment to end the shame of racism in America. We have searched our souls, and we have come up short. Let me say it better. I have searched my soul, and I've come up short. God woke me up a few nights ago at 4 a.m., and we did a brief review of my life and my relationship to racism. From when I dated a biracial boy in high school and had to confront my parents' fear and my friends' rejection, to attending Duke in North Carolina and visiting my roommate's hometown about an hour away and being confronted by the sign on the edge of town that said, "The town of the Ku Klux Klan welcomes you to Smithfield," in 1986. To when I heard my black clergy colleagues discuss which towns in Illinois they felt comfortable stopping in for gas or going to the bathroom on their way home from conference meetings. To being appointed to a small town in East Central Illinois that had a reputation as a sundown town, a place where African Americans were not welcome after dark. To the stories from friends who feared their black and brown children might be stopped by police in Springfield, which led them to having the talk that many black and brown children get about how to survive getting pulled over by the police. Then there were the books I've read about systemic race issues and economic oppression in America, and most recently hearing my granddaughter, who is of mixed racial heritage, describing the taunts and exclusion because she was browner than her classmates in her Catholic school. This middle of the night review reminded me that I already knew better. I don't know everything, but I knew enough. And still I had not engaged in working for the change I know is needed and that I believe God desires. I had taken the easy way, the lazy way, the wishful way of hoping that injustice would magically disappear, with no effort on my part. So God woke me up, literally woke me up, broke my heart, and called me to the first work of faithful Christianity: repent. My middle of the night visit from God ended in tears, prayer, and a renewed commitment to do better. So I stand before you today, not in self-righteous zeal, but with a broken, repentant heart for failing to fulfill my call to ministry and the baptism vows I have renewed every single time someone has joined the church, to accept the freedom and power God gives us to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves. I have known better. I have been afraid of upsetting the easy balance. I have been afraid to challenge the people of God, knowing there are those who disagree with me. I've spoken around racism instead of working to dismantle it. And I repent of my sin. When Peter preached so long ago, he instructed people to repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, so that your sins may be forgiven and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. So I'm here to tell you today, repentance isn't the end of God's work. It is the beginning. Repent, be baptized and forgiven, but then there's this: rise up in power. Today I'd like to share what I believe God is inviting me to do next. First, to use my voice. Today I'd like to be very clear. I have been clear with you about how I feel about LGBTQ inclusion. I'd like to be clear with you about how I feel about the issues facing us this week. These words that I share are actually from my daughter's Facebook page, and I agree with her 100%. I believe black lives matter, and that there needs to be serious work done in the hearts of white people to break down the racism inherently in us because of societal norms. That's where I stand. Second, I'm going to listen. I invite you to join me in studies and discussions that will help us do the work of addressing white fragility, white privilege, and open our eyes to systemic racism and economic oppression for the long haul. Not just now in the heat of this moment, but as a commitment to stay engaged past the point of emotional outrage. This is what I must learn. And finally, I plan to act. I don't know what this is yet, but I'm asking you to hold me accountable. I'm not sure if this means supporting Black-owned businesses, joining the NAACP, or another group that's engaged in social justice, such as Show Up for Racial Justice, or standing along protesters who are demanding change. Maybe it means financially supporting movements agitating for racial progress. Maybe it means all these things. But for certain, I must do something. Use my voice, listen, and act. Perhaps you are experiencing a similar call from God in your life. Perhaps this week is the turning point for many of us. Perhaps God is breaking your heart, calling you to repentance and eager to raise you up in power. So what difference does a week make? I guess we can ask ourselves that question again a year from now, after we've taken a stand, after we've listened hard, after we've stepped out in action. Will this week make a difference? Time will tell. Will you join with me in prayer? We open ourselves, Lord, to your healing Holy Spirit. We stand in the power of your love, convicted by your words, calling us to greater justice in the world. Forgive us for the ways that we have failed and raise us up in power to do better. I ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. I invite you to make an offering of your whole selves, every part of your heart and mind and spirit, to bring the strength of your resources into this place that we might continue the mission and ministry of this congregation. Let us make our offerings to God. Thank you. The kingdom of God is like a seed planted in a woman's heart, slowly, silently stretching it beyond family and friends, church and nation, until one day that heart bursts open, revealing a table wider than the world, warm as an intimate embrace. To this table, everyone is invited. No one is a stranger. No one is unfit. Each brings a gift, the work of one's own hands, heart, mind, a morsel for the table. And there's always enough. Enough because no one keeps hidden the bread of the morrow. Enough because in the sharing is the miracle of multiplication. Around this table, everyone eats and no one is stuffed. Each sips deeply of love unearned and offers the cup to one another. From this table, each rises, strengthened by a morsel and a sip, heart seated, pregnant. Christ our Lord invites to this table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. O God, today we confess that the sin of racial hatred and prejudice distorts your divine plan for our human lives. You created us in divine likeness, diverse and beautiful. In every person, every race is your image. But too often we fail to recognize your image in all. Forgive us. You created us in divine freedom to be free. In every decision, every choice is your possibility of justice. But too often we fail to choose to advocate for your justice for all. Forgive us. You created us for divine abundance to tend and share in every garden, every social structure is your seed of community. But too often we fail to create that community which includes all and gives to all equal access to your abundant life. Forgive us. Forgive us. Open our eyes to distinguish good from evil. Open our hearts to desire good over evil. Strengthen our wills to choose good over evil, so that we may create among us your beloved community. Let us go to God and confess our sins in silence. Hear the good news. God's gift of grace in Jesus Christ forgives us and sets us free to live full human lives in community. We may go forth confident of the grace to see with new eyes beyond racial prejudice, to imagine with renewed fervor justice and mercy for all, and to create with a new will a community where all are given access to God's abundant life. Thanks be to God. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, God Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to proclaim good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. Jesus healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and Holy Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, Jesus took bread, gave thanks to you, broke it, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, when the supper was over, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's sacrifice for us, as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world. Until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, with the confidence of children, let us pray the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
Thank you. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
People of God, it is time to get connected. If you are sitting with family or friends, please join hands. If you are here worshiping with us online and you are sitting at home alone, you are connected to us by Spirit. May you go from this place to love God with your whole heart, to love your neighbor as yourself, and to see the face of Jesus in every person you pass. Go in peace.